This is the Brother Henry and You Show, where you can be inspired, uplifted, and edified through the Word of God. Enjoy today's program.
The Bible says in Psalms chapter 91, verse 1, it says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee," and I'm going to read this last verse, "He shall cover thee with His feathers. Under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler." And truly, there is a very important scripture. I believe that Jesus Christ, He is our shelter in the time of need, in the time of destruction. We can go to Him. He is our guide. He is our shield. He's our fortress. Why don't you trust Him today to be your Most High God? Why don't you hide under the shadow of the Almighty God and watch Him do extraordinary things in your life? God bless you. This is Brother Henry Harris. I'm so delighted you took this opportunity out of your busy schedule to watch us today. I pray what will be said today will bless you, will encourage you. You know, you hear me say this all the time. I believe the body of Christ should be all about edification. You know, there are so many people that likes putting people down, but I believe if you look down on someone, it should be to pick them up and not to discourage them. And that's why we're here. If you're down, if you're discouraged, if you're looking for hope, if you're looking for a reassurance, if you're looking for another push, we're here to give you that in Jesus' name. We can't do it, but it's Christ through us that can. We have Brother Chris Crosby here with us today. Great friend, great man of God. He carries the cross around, sharing the message of Jesus Christ. Goes to different cities, sharing the message of hope with people. And, you know, I'm always moved when I see him carrying that cross around, because it reminds me of the cross of Jesus Christ, how when Jesus went up to the cross and died for my sins, it gave me the peace of mind. It gave me assurance that I had eternal life. So I really appreciate that. We need more people to be carrying crosses. We need more people to be out there sharing the Word of God and sharing the message of love to the world. Before we turn it over to Brother Chris, I would like to say a prayer for you this morning. Lord, we thank you this morning. Thank you, Lord, that we do dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Lord, we thank you for covering us with your feathers, covering us with your wings. Lord, we just praise you this morning. Thank you, first of all, for waking us up, giving us peace of mind. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the right mind. Thank you for giving us the right attitude. Lord, we praise you, Lord, because this is another day that we can be a blessing to someone. Lord, well, 10 or thousands are watching this video. Lord, I pray that there be at least one person that be touched by this video, Lord. Lord, our desire here, Lord, is to reach out, to edify, to inspire, to build the body of Christ. So those that are discouraged, those that are down, I pray that something that Brother Chris says today that will bless them. I also pray for Brother Chris, Lord, that you would intensify the anointing that's on his life, that what he will share will not come from him. It'll be the Holy Spirit that's speaking through him. And Lord, we just give you the praise. We love you this morning. We appreciate you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for everything you're doing in our life. We want to just give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. We have Brother Chris with us today. It's a pleasure to have him here, and at this time, we're going to turn it over to him and let him share what God's been dealing with him about. A lot of you have been waiting to watch this, so at this time, we'll turn it over to him.
Thank you, Brother Henry. what you just said is exactly right. It's what God has been dealing with me about, and that's what I want to share today. It's not, I didn't go home and prepare some message.
Mm-hmm.
The message that I want to share today is exactly what God has been dealing with me about. And it's not about whether I'm saved or not,
mm-hmm.
but it's about walking in the fullness that God intends us to walk in. And culmination of things have really just been weighing heavy on me lately, in a good way. Mm-hmm. And I believe the message would be to edify those that are saved, mm-hmm. to help move them into a full relationship with God, mm-hmm. a more full relationship than we're in today. When I go out there, you mentioned that I go out there on the streets and I carry the cross.
We've seen that.
When I'm out there, I see a lot of people who say, yes, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. But yet when you talk to them, you find out that their life doesn't say that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Their life doesn't say that I am a believer in Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. I heard a pastor one time say that, preach the gospel in everything you do and even use words if you have to.
Yeah.
And that tells me I ought to be living it out. People ought to be able to see a difference in me. And I heard it said just recently, when you look at yourself in the mirror and see your Christianity, mm-hmm. is that what you want the world to look at as a model? Do you want them to look at you and say, that's the type of man of God or woman of God that I want to be? Mm-hmm. And the truth is, in a Bible study I've been doing, in an in-home Bible study that I've been doing for quite some time, just got a new series of study, and mm-hmm. it pointed out to me that I need to look at the aspects of my life. Mm-hmm. Each individual aspect of my life, and is this a godly aspect, the way I'm doing life? Am I doing it the way God wants me to, or am I doing it the way the world does? Mm-hmm. Because if there's no difference between me and the world, I might as well put my cross up mm-hmm. and stop walking down the road. Mm-hmm. If they can't see a difference in me, mm-hmm. and not because of who I am, but because of what God's done in me, if mm-hmm. they can't see that difference, then I might as well put my cross up mm-hmm. and stop carrying it down the road. Mm-hmm. Stop telling people about Jesus, because there's no difference.
Amen.
There is an absolute difference that God wants in us. And I started looking at things. There's a scripture that says, it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, mm-hmm. but it's the glory of kings to search a matter out. Mm-hmm. And I started thinking about that. And my first thoughts were, that tells me that it brings God pleasure to hide things from us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking at that from the wrong side. Uh-huh. When I look at that scripture like that, that means that when I think that that's what that scripture means, that means that God gets pleasure out of irritating me, hiding things from me. Uh-huh. And that's not true. Mm-hmm. God loves me. Mm-hmm. He has more value in his heart and in his eye for me than all mm-hmm. of creation. Anybody I know, nobody cares for me like God does. So for me to say that God gets pleasure out of irritating me like that mm-hmm. is wrong. Mm-hmm. So I had to look at that scripture again, and it says it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, but it's the glory of kings to search a matter out. I started looking at that from another perspective. Mm-hmm. If it was you have a child, mm-hmm. and I have children, mm-hmm. and I don't know. I know the world participates in what they call Easter.
Yeah.
I call it Resurrection Day now. Amen. But there was a time when I participated mm-hmm. in it. When my daughter was little, mm-hmm. I'd go out and I'd hide the Easter eggs for mm-hmm. her. I'd go out and hide them all over, and then I'd sit and watch her running around. And as she found them, it brought me pleasure. Mm-hmm. She had fun finding them. Mm-hmm. And I had fun watching her find them. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what that scripture is. God has not hidden these things from us. He's hidden them for us. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing. He's hidden these things out there because he wants us to find them. Mm-hmm. It brings him joy. It brings us joy when we find them, and it brings him joy when he sees us find them. Mm-hmm. And the search form shows God that we truly care. Mm-hmm. When we care enough to search a matter out. But I started digging deep into that and trying to understand what are these things that are hidden that he wants me to find, that it brings us both joy when I find. And I started looking over my life and I saw these issues in my life that didn't necessarily, they were not necessarily bad, but I was having struggles. And they seemed to be repeating themselves over and over in my life. And God wants me to, doesn't want me to keep going through those things. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want my life to look like everybody else's all the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are going to be struggles in my life. And most of the time, not always, but it's because I have put my affection or attention towards the wrong thing. Mm-hmm. And God, those are the things God wants me to search out. And all of the answers are in that Bible.
Amen.
Every one of them. And if they're not, if you can't, they are in there, but if you can't find them, mm-hmm. that's why Jesus said, get in that closet. Mm-hmm. Get in your prayer closet. Mm-hmm. Get on your knees. The Bible promises us that if we need wisdom, God is faithful. He will mm-hmm. give us an abundance of wisdom. So I'm looking at these issues in my life, and I'm thinking, I don't want to keep doing this. Mm-hmm. So I start believing what God said. He'll give me wisdom, and he does. He gives it every time, believing. Faith says that I don't see it, but I know it's coming.
Amen.
It is on the way. Mm-hmm. I may not have it in my hand yet. If I have it in my hand, I don't need faith anymore. Mm-hmm. But faith says, I don't have it in my hand yet.
Don't see it.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I know this wisdom is coming. And I'm telling you, God uses everything. He uses everything out there to point out to me his wisdom, his perfection. And even this morning, I'm looking at different aspects of my life, the issues in my life, and I'm looking to God for the answers. And God uses, you know, in Corinthians, it says all creation, or is it Romans? I don't remember. All creation testifies. Mm-hmm. All creation testifies. Mm-hmm. So this morning, I'm looking at a coffee cup. Mm-hmm. I got it. I've had a couple cups of coffee, and I'm done. I'm getting ready to put it in the sink, rinse it out, and I looked at it, and all of a sudden I hear God speaking to me from what I see, and you know, I'm asking myself, really, aren't you going a little deep here, Chris, mm-hmm. looking at a coffee cup turning this into a God thing?
Yeah.
But the truth was, God showed me that my intention was to pour coffee in that cup and then to pour it from the cup into my mouth. Mm-hmm. But as I went to that sink, I saw coffee on the outside of the cup that had run down the outside mm-hmm. of it. And that wasn't the intention. I missed the mark, mm-hmm. even just a little bit, mm-hmm. in those three cups. And that's what happens when I have these irritations in my life. I've missed the mark a little bit. Mm-hmm. Maybe not completely, but God doesn't want me to keep missing the mark. Mm-hmm. And that's where he gives us this wisdom. When we have these, especially Christians, see, if you're not a believer in God, mm-hmm. God has no promise he has to honor if you're not a believer. Mm-hmm. But as a believer, God has all these promises for us. Jesus said, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Mm-hmm. Well, we want to be free. Everybody wants to be free. Mm-hmm. But Jesus didn't say you'll just be free. He said free indeed.
Yeah.
He said, he also said that he came to give us life and life more abundantly. Mm-hmm. We all want life, but Jesus didn't stop there. He said more abundantly. Mm-hmm. So if as a Christian, I'm not experiencing these promises, something's wrong, and it's not God. Mm-hmm. That's why God wants me as, you know, Jesus said, I'm the Lord of lords and I'm the King of kings. Mm-hmm. Well, if he's my king and he says he's the King of kings, that makes me a king. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm the Lord of lords. He says, well, if he's my Lord, then that makes me a Lord.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
See, I am a royal priesthood today mm-hmm. because of Jesus Christ. Not of my own doing. I wasn't born in a royal family, but Jesus Christ makes me by his blood, mm-hmm. by the blood that was shed on the cross, covers me. Mm-hmm. He covers me and makes me of a royal priesthood. All God's doing, not no help of my own. So he says it's the glory of a king to search a matter out. Mm-hmm. He's talking to me. Mm-hmm. Search a matter out. Well, I'm looking at these things and I'm thinking, am I experiencing life? And life more abundantly? Mm-hmm. And then I look at my Christian walk and I see these areas where I've stumbled, and I see these areas where God's picked me back up, and then it was really good, and then I see a stumble again, and I'm like, God, I don't want to keep doing this. I don't want to keep going. I want to walk with you. Mm-hmm. And that was his intention in the beginning. In the garden, he walked with Adam. Mm-hmm. And God says, the areas where you stumble, those areas where Christians in general, all of us, where we stumble and fall down here and there, mm-hmm. those are the areas where we're still attached to the world, mm-hmm. where we're seeking I'll give you an example of this. This past weekend, I went camping with a Christian brother and his grandchildren and his son and my son. We all went camping. We rode ahead on our motorcycles and pitched our tents and everything. Well, at the other end of the campground, they had this big party going on, and my son even mentioned to me in the middle of it, he said, "Dad, it might be a good opportunity for ministry down there." Well, I didn't want to go be in the middle of all this stuff at nighttime, and I just didn't, God hadn't put it on my heart to go down there and do ministry in there, so I wasn't going to go and work in the flesh and fall on my face. Mm-hmm. So I just looked at my son, and I said, "Well, if that's the case, God will have to put it in my face." Mm-hmm. Well, sure enough, within just a few minutes, three guys walk all the way from the other end of the campground where they're partying, up here to talk to us about motorcycles. All three of them got beers in their hands. Hmm. Well, we start talking to them about our bikes and whatnot, and sharing Jesus Christ with them. It's not long, and this guy doesn't want that beer in his hand anymore.
Oh, wow.
And he was telling me about what he believes and whatnot, and I was telling him about what Jesus has done in my life, how he delivered me, and how he's changed me, and I'm not who I once was. I'm being renewed, you know? Mm-hmm. And he asked me this question. He goes, "Well, what about pot?" Mm-hmm. He said, "God made pot." And I said, "Well, absolutely he did." And the first thing that popped in my mind is I wanted to tell him. I wanted to say, "He made poison oak too."
Yeah.
"But you ain't smoking it."
Yeah.
But anyway, instead of doing that, God just on the spot gave me wisdom. Mm-hmm. And I said, "Yes, he did create that pot plant." Mm-hmm. I said, "Tomorrow morning when you wake up," I said, "if you're up early enough, you watch that horizon in the east, mm-hmm. and there's going to be a ball of fire that comes up over those trees." Mm-hmm. And I said, "That ball of fire is 93 million miles away from us." Mm-hmm. And I said, "And if you stand in it long enough, it'll burn your skin mm-hmm. at 93 million miles away." Mm-hmm. I said, "That's power." Mm-hmm. I said, "That ball of fire has been coming up day after day for 6,000 years, and it's been burning for 6,000 years. Mm-hmm. I said, "It puts out more energy in a second than the earth uses in I don't know how long, but 1 second, it puts out enough energy to supply all of the energy that the earth needs." Mm-hmm. And I said, "That's real power there." Mm-hmm. He goes, "Yeah." I said, "You know, he created that," mm-hmm. which means he's greater than that. I said, "And when he created it, he didn't get a toolbox out. He spoke. He said, 'Let there be light.' Bam." Mm-hmm. There was light, and it's been burning ever since. Mm-hmm. You ever lit a fire that burned 6,000 years? Mm-mm. Well, God did. You see, the point I want to get across is this. He is greater than the thing he created. Mm-hmm. He's more powerful than that ball of fire in the sky. Mm-hmm. He's more powerful than the pot plant. Mm-hmm. And I asked him, I said, "You smoke that pot because you want to feel better, right?" He says, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, if the pot plant can make you feel better, and he is greater than the thing he created, how much better can he make you feel?" Mm-hmm. You see, here's where his issue was in life. He is worshiping the creation mm-hmm. rather than the creator. Mm-hmm. He was going to creation to feel better rather than the creator. Mm-hmm. You see, Jesus said, "You can have life." Mm-hmm. He said, "But I want to give you life more abundantly." Mm-hmm. So when I started searching this matter out and looking at all these little aspects, I see that what God is saying is our attention. The second commandment says we shall have no idols. Mm-hmm. None. The first commandment says he's the Lord God, you shall have no other gods.
Amen.
Second commandment, you know, and I'm not a law preacher. You know that, brother. You know what? I'm a living example of that. Mm-hmm. God's grace is more than sufficient, mm-hmm. greater than any sin. But the law was not done away with. Mm-hmm. It was fulfilled. Mm-hmm. Jesus fulfilled it on my behalf. Mm-hmm. He fulfilled it and received righteousness for it and gives me his righteousness. I didn't earn it. He did. He earned it for me.
Amen.
That's grace of God. Mm-hmm. But the commandments are there for a mirror so that I can see myself, mm-hmm. so I can see how I stand up to the righteousness of God. Mm-hmm. So, I'm looking at these commandments and I see the first commandment is I shall have no other gods. Mm-hmm. Second commandment says I shall not worship any idols mm-hmm. in any way, shape, or form. And it says because God's a jealous God. Mm-hmm. as I was looking into these things, Martin Luther said, you know, all the rest of the commandments, first part of them deal with your relationship with God, the rest of them deal with your relationship with people. Mm-hmm. Martin Luther said, you can't break any of the last ones unless you first break those first two. Mm. You have to break the first two first to break any other commandment. Mm. You have to have either some sort of idol in your life, mm-hmm. or worshiping a God. I started looking into this, and this Bible study I'm doing just impacted me heavy. These struggles that we go through as a believer, that we continue to go through, is because of idolatry. Mm-hmm. And none of us say we've got carved images. I'm not sitting here worshiping some image, and I don't go out and bow to stars and moons, and I don't do any of those things. I don't worship idols. Mm-hmm. But the truth of the matter is, in little aspects of my life, there are idols, just like with this guy. He idolized that pot. Mm-hmm. He wanted to justify his relationship with that pot. Well, why not have a relationship with the God that created these things? Mm-hmm. We worship money, mm-hmm. we worship food, we worship sex, pornography, mm-hmm. gambling, we worship power. You know, I want the best office in the building, mm-hmm. I want the highest pay, I want the greatest title over on my desk and on my door. Yeah, no.
Amen.
No. God's way is completely opposite mm-hmm. of that. And this is why we go through these struggles over and over and over, because we've got these gods, these idols in our lives. Mm-hmm. And God doesn't want us to go through those. Mm-hmm. And he's made it very simple. The answers are in his word. Mm-hmm. He says, humble yourself and I'll exalt you. Mm-hmm. So if I, instead of me trying to achieve my own status in life, either by my pride or my ego or all these things, if I instead of doing that, seek out God. Mm-hmm. He says, if I humbly come before him, if I get on my knees in a closet, literally, I've literally been doing this, mm-hmm. and I'm telling you, it's changing my life, brother. Changing, I've been I don't want to sound prideful, but God has given me a gift and ability to share Jesus Christ with anybody, anywhere, anytime, and do it well. Mm-hmm. But God has been changing me on the inside between him and I in a way that is very, very, very awesome. And he's doing it through humility, just getting on my knees in the closet and closing everything, turning everything off. Don't want to hear noise. I just want to spend time with God. And I'm telling you, he's changing me. And it's for his glory. And that's our purpose in life. Our purpose is to have this relationship with him. You know, and God didn't stop when he said, it's all for my glory. He says numerous times, he gives us glory. Mm-hmm. And when God gives us glory, we know we're standing in our true purpose. When we receive glory from God, we know we are doing what we are created to be. Mm-hmm. And instead of being caught up in the things that the world chases after, and having God says he's jealous. Mm-hmm. When we're caught up in these things, this is why we have the struggles. Mm-hmm. Because we're caught up in these things, serving these idols in our lives, and God is jealous. Mm-hmm. A jealous God lets us know, whether it be letting us taste the fruit of our labor over here and letting it be the emptiness that it brings. Because money, I mean, look at the wealthiest men in the world. They didn't reach some status of wealth and then say, okay, I'm done, I retire. No, they're out there still buying other companies, trying mm-hmm. to achieve higher, because where is enough? Mm-hmm. Where is it enough in the relationship that you stop putting the burden on your partner in your relationship of making you feel the way you need to? Where is it enough in your job when you reach the ceiling in there and you still feel empty? God allows us to taste those things in our life, to experience those things, mm-hmm. because our attention's on the wrong thing. He says, I'm jealous. That means he won't tolerate our affection being for these other things. Mm-hmm. So he allows these things to happen. And I don't believe God today, because of Jesus, because we're under the new covenant that Jesus Christ brought us, that God does harm to anybody. Mm-hmm. Now he'll allow us to experience things in our lives. And it's only because he wants our attention. Mm-hmm. He wants our full devotion to him. Mm-hmm. He says, everything you chase after, I own. Mm-hmm. Everything. All of this building material, it's not his because we say it.
Mm-hmm.
All of this came from creation. We didn't create anything. This planet offers us the things that we use, and it all belongs to him. It's all his.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever we need in life, he freely has it to give.
Amen.
So if we're chasing after these other things, trying to get them on our own, God may or may not allow you to have them. And that's not even the point. The point is that God wants you to recognize him. He wants your relationship to be greater than your relationship with these things.
Mm-hmm.
Even greater than our relationships with our family. We get things out of order, and God says that brings chaos.
Mm-hmm.
God is not the author of confusion.
Mm-hmm.
God doesn't do that. So the answer that God has been giving me is that as I encounter these idols in my life, that I need to dethrone them.
Mm-hmm.
And my focus even in that should not be on just dethroning the idol or the problems that they cause, but when I push that idol out of the throne,
mm-hmm.
that I enthrone Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And as I do that, peace comes into my life. Joy comes into my life. Rather than the emptiness, the confusion, and the aggravation, and the depression, and everything else that comes with the emptiness that all these other things leave us with.
Mm-hmm.
But fullness from the Creator. Fullness from God in our own lives. And as we walk in that, God sees us turning our attention to him rather than on these things. And that brings him joy. We have found, we've searched the matter out. We found out that there is an idol here. And God says, you dethrone that thing of your own choice. And he says, and then of your own choosing, you've enthroned me. And it's like that Easter egg hunt. It
mm-hmm.
brings him joy. And it brings us joy. And there really, can there be anything greater? And I'm not talking about happiness. I'm talking about joy.
Mm-hmm.
Joy that lasts. And as God steps in and takes over that area, I don't need to have this. I don't need to have that. I don't need to be this. And I don't
mm-hmm.
need to be that according to the way the world does things.
Mm-hmm.
What I need is him.
Mm-hmm.
He gives all. In humility, I seek him. And in his joy, he exalts me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, sometimes people wonder why church people get together and they sing on Sunday morning.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because of that.
Mm-hmm.
We go to sing and tell him, you, it's all about you. What you've done, what you're doing, what you're going to do. And I know that I can rest and trust in you today. You've got my best interest in mind here and in eternal life. Now, this is life. Life more abundantly is coming. And Jesus even says that whatever we give up for him, when we move all these idols out of our lives, he says, when we dethrone all those, he says, I'll give you that in this life and in the life to come 100-fold.
Hmm.
I watched an interview of one of the other people you interviewed, and they talked about all the friends of their past that they didn't unfriend them.
Mm-hmm.
They just kind of just fell out of their lives. But God had given them multiple friends out of a Christian family.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way God is. God doesn't do equals. You can't outgive him. God gives greater always. Always. And he shows that all through Scripture. That you give up your life and he gives you a new life and eternal life. He doesn't just give you a new life.
Amen.
He's greater. He's so much greater than we could ever achieve here on our own. And so that's the message that God has put on my heart today, is to encourage people to not just, you know, I punch the time card on Sunday morning, I punch the time card on Wednesday night
mm-hmm.
when I show up at the church, and I even throw money in the plate, and I might even read and pray. I go through all this religious routine, but God says no, this is about a real thing.
Mm-hmm.
And all those things are good.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong, I'm not down on those things. All those things are good, but God says I want to have a real and powerful, a vibrant relationship with you, and I want to use you to change the world. He doesn't want you to change this one person's life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that'd be a great thing, just to help change to the vessel that God uses to change one person's life. He wants to change the world with his people. But that's not going to be done with Christians that have one foot in the church and the other foot in the world. Mm-hmm. God wants us to be firmly planted in the kingdom. And so my message today is that search the matter out and see the glory that God reveals and gives.
Amen. Thank you, bro.
You bet.
I enjoyed that. Would you mind saying a closing prayer to those that are watching
online? Absolutely.
There may even be somebody that's watching that don't even know the Lord. And like you said, their hearts is into the creation rather than the Creator. Why don't you leave them?
As Brother Henry said, I don't know where you are today, whether you may be a Christian who's struggling. You may not be a Christian, but I can tell you this, the promises of God are only good to those who put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he has so many promises. His heart is for you, not against you. And today, all those promises can be available. God himself can be available to you simply by the price that was paid through his son, Jesus Christ. And that's where it all starts. You can't worry about this until you deal. It's kind of like trying to go up a flight of steps, starting at the bottom and leaping to the middle. You may get lucky, but you may not, and the tumble down is hard. So start with the first step where God wants you to be, and that is to receive Jesus Christ in your life. And from that point, let the wisdom of God change you. And if you would, if this message has stirred you, provoked you in any way, towards the heart of God. It is as simple as asking him, God, I know I'm not right with you. I know I haven't been. But I ask you to forgive me. I ask you, Father God, that you would look into my life and cover me with the blood of your son, Jesus Christ, that makes me right, with you. It's as simple as asking God to give you Jesus, to cover your whole life. And God does that at that point. He no longer looks upon you as somebody who has been at war with him. He looks upon you as his own child, somebody of royal blood from that point forward. And he wants to change. He wants to change your heart. He wants to change your mind. So just ask him. Open hands show that you have nothing to offer him. It also shows that you have no weapon against him. The open hands just say, God, I have nothing. I have nothing to offer you, but I ask you. I ask you, come into my life and change it. Change it to be a life that pleases you. I want that life that you said I could have. I want it's not just life, but life more abundantly. I want to be free. So I ask you, Jesus, that you see me today in need of you. I receive you into my life. I receive you into my heart. I want you to be my Lord. I want you to be my King. I want you to be my Savior. And all of those are important. All three. It needs to be all three of those to you. And if you just prayed that prayer, thank God. Thank God. And Father, I ask you that you would touch the people viewing this, the hearers of this word, and I pray in the name of Jesus that help somebody to bring glory to your name. And Father God, you would pour your blessings into their life. Father God, they'd have no lack, that they would see that your hand has provided, that you love them, that you care for them. And I ask this all in the one who saved me. You saved me from myself. You saved me from the evil one. Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. God bless you, Brother Chris.
Thank you.
Yeah, God bless you. That was an awesome message. Eyes haven't seen, neither ears haven't heard. Neither has it entered the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those that love him. God loves you today, as Brother Chris stated. And you give your heart to the Lord. We'd like to hear about it. Send us a message at the Brother Henry and Youth Show. We'd like to share it with others. If you're giving your heart to Jesus Christ, it's the most precious gift you can ever receive.
You have this whole world, and you don't have Jesus. To be honest with you, you don't have nothing. It's when you accept him into your heart and give him your all, that's when you begin to receive his riches and receive his blessing. God bless you. You have a friend in me. I thoroughly appreciate you for watching. Have a blessed and glorious and victorious and prosperous week.